Hello. In our last session, we discussed two terms, person and SSC. In this session, I would tell you the next two important terms, assessment year, section 2.9, and previous year, section 3. Since these two are related terms, I would tell you the relation in between these two. Once we would be able to understand these two terms, we would also be able to understand the basic rule or the general rule of income tax. I would tell you what is the basic rule. And with this basic rule, there are certain exceptions attached there. I would also discuss the exceptions of basic rule given under section 172 to 176. So let us start the session now with the term assessment year. What is assessment year? Section 2.9. All of you know that in accountancy, when we refer to an year, we usually call it a financial year, maybe an accounting year, sometimes calendar year also, but we refer to an year as a financial year or an accounting year, right? Similarly, in case of income tax, in relation to year, we have these two terms. One is assessment year, second is the previous year. That means normally when we have to refer an year, either we would call it an assessment year or we would call it a previous year. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of assessment year? Assessment year is very similar to financial year. In a financial year, there are always 12 months starting from 1st of April to 31st March of the following year. That is your financial year. Okay. And that again is your accounting year also. Generally, right? So assessment year also is a period of 12 months starting from 1st of April and ends on 31st of March of the next year. So I would write it. The assessment year is, it is a period of 12 months which starts from 1st of April, okay, and ends on 31st of March of the next year. This is what an assessment year is. Section 2.9 says that assessment year, it is a period of 12 months starting from 1st of April of the current year and ends on 31st of March of the following year or the next year. Okay. What is a previous year? What is a previous year? A previous year is the financial year which immediately precedes the assessment year. The financial year which immediately precedes the assessment year. Okay, so it becomes very simple now. If your assessment year is 2021-22, your previous year would be 2020-21 because the previous year is the financial year which immediately precedes the assessment year. Let me write this also. If your assessment year is 2021-22, the previous year would be 2020-21 because this is the year which immediately precedes this year. So this is the previous year, and for this previous year, this is the assessment year. And now you know why I was calling, why I was saying that these two are related terms. Okay. Assessment year, normally, not normally, always a period of 12 months. But previous year, normally a period of 12 months, but in one situation, there is a situation where your previous year would not be of full 12 months. It may have a period which is less than 12 months. What is that case? The case is, or the situation is, in case of a new source of income, okay, the previous year would start from the date when this new source of income has emerged, and it would go up to 31st March of the following year. Okay, for example, after you qualified this, let us suppose that you start your practice from 1st of September. Okay, now if you started your practice on 1st of September, that means the first previous year for you. Okay, why I'm calling it first? Because this is the first time you have started, you know, earning. Okay, so the very first year when you have started your business or started your practice, okay, your previous year would start from the date when you started your practice, that means 1st of September, and it would go up to the same date, 31st March of the next year. So yes, then there would be a period which is less than 12 months in that previous year. So only in one situation, and that situation is where a new source of income has emerged, the previous year may have a period which could be less than 12 months. Otherwise, even previous year in general would be a period of 12 months. Okay. Now, if I extend my example further, the next year when you would continue your practice, the next year, the next previous year for you would also be a period of 12 months. Okay. You started your practice on 1st of September. So the very first previous year for you would start from 1st of September and it would go up to 31st March of the next year. But the next year on 1st of April, you are continuing your profession. Okay. So your previous year would then start from 1st of April itself and would go up to 31st March of the next year. So that means then in your second previous year, it would be a period of full 12 months. Okay. In case of assessment year, it would always be of 12 months. In case of previous year, generally it is of 12 months, but only in a situation where a new source of income has emerged. In that case, the previous year could have a period which could be less than 12 months. Fine. Now, let us again try to see the relation between these two. Okay. The relation between these two is that the previous year would immediately precede the assessment year, or in other words, the assessment year would always succeed the previous year. Okay. See, if your assessment year is 2021-22, we would say that the previous year in relation to this assessment year is 2020-21. Okay. If somebody says that the previous year is 2020-21 and he would ask you what is the assessment year for this previous year, what you would say? You would say the assessment year for this would be 2021-22. Okay. That means the assessment year would always succeed the previous year, whereas the previous year would always precede the assessment year. Okay. Now, even though every single financial year, it would be an assessment year also, and it would be the previous year also. Every single financial year, every single year, it is an assessment year, it is a previous year also. Okay. For example, here I am saying that 2020-21 is the previous year. But if I write here 2019-20 as a previous year, and if now I ask you, what is the assessment year for the previous year 2019-20? You would say, sir, the assessment year for this previous year 19-20 would be 2020-21. So that means in relation to this previous year, this becomes the assessment year. Okay, so every single year it would be an assessment year and it would also be a previous year. Okay, it depends that in what subject, in what relation, in what scene you are really, you know, trying to portray that year. Okay, in what reference you are talking about that particular year, that depends on this. Now, I think the relation is very clear now. If the previous year is 1920, assessment year would be 2020-21. If 2020-21 is previous year, then for this, the assessment year would be 2021-22. And if your 21-22 is the previous year, the assessment year for this would then become 2022-23. Got it? So, this is the relation between previous year and assessment year. Now, to denote a particular previous year that it is related to a particular assessment year, generally we use the word relevant. Okay. Now, because every single financial year is an assessment year and also a previous year, the use of this word relevant clarifies everything then. Okay. Like, if I say that for the assessment year 2021-22, which one is the previous year? Even though both of these years are also previous years, but we would say that the relevant previous year for the assessment year 2021-22 is 2020-21. Okay. So whenever we use this word relevant, okay, this makes it very clear that what really we want to say. Okay. Now, if I ask that what is the relevant previous year for the assessment year 2020-21, you would say that the relevant previous year for 2021 is 2019-20. Okay. So, I am again repeating this. All of these 3 years, they are also assessment year, they are also previous year. So, every single year is an assessment year and also a previous year. Okay. Using the word relevant before the year would give you the clarity. Right. As I gave the example, the assessment year for this previous year is this. Okay. That means the relevant previous year for this assessment year is this. Got it? This is how this word relevant is used here in income tax. Okay. Now, you know what is the meaning of assessment year and what is the meaning of previous year. Okay. In context of income tax, we generally use these two terms in relation to an year. Okay. The relation between these 2 years, previous year and assessment year, is that assessment year would always succeed the previous year. It would be the immediately succeeding year of the previous year. Okay. If somebody asks that whether for previous year 1920, the assessment year would be 21-22. No. The immediately succeeding year would be the assessment year. That means for previous year 1920, the assessment year would be 2021 and not 21-22. Got it? In assessment year, we assess the income of the SSC which he has earned during the previous year. I am repeating this sentence. In the assessment year, we assess the income of the SSC which he has earned during the previous year. That means the income which is earned by an SSC, say Mr. X, during 1920 would get assessed in the assessment year 2021. Got it? Again, when Mr. X is continuing his you know, earning of income, he is still into his business or in job, whatever into he is, right? That means when it comes to 2021, now 2021 becomes the previous year. He is earning his income in this year now. Then for this year, his assessment year would be the immediately succeeding year, which is 2021-22. Okay. So, in assessment year, we assess the income earned by the SSC during the previous year. Okay. And if you use the word relevant, this would make the things very clear, right? That means in the assessment year 2021-22, the income which is earned by the SSC in the relevant previous year, which would be 2021, that would get assessed in the assessment year 21-22. You are getting it? There is no problem, you know, understanding that, right? Always remember that these two are subjective terms. These mostly are used, you know, in relation to each other. Okay? And the relation between these two is what? The assessment year would always succeed, immediately succeed the previous year. In other words, the previous year would immediately precede the assessment year. Okay? Now, we know what is assessment year and previous year. Now is the time to tell you the basic rule of income tax, because this basic rule of income tax is completely based on these two terms. What is the basic rule? Or at times, you know, they call it the general rule, but I would call it the basic rule. The basic rule of income tax is that the income which is earned during the previous year, the basic rule is nothing but the relation between these 2 years. The basic rule is that the income which is earned during the previous year is to be assessed in the immediately succeeding year called assessment year. Okay, this is the basic rule of income tax. And this is such a popular rule, almost everybody knows about it. Okay, everybody knows that the income which we have earned in this year, it would get assessed in the next year. Everybody knows about it. Okay, this is the basic rule. Let me write the basic rule here. Income earned during the previous year is to be assessed in the immediately succeeding year called assessment year. This is our basic rule. Okay. The income earned in this year would get assessed, would get taxed in the next year. Next year, the immediate next year is our assessment year. Okay. Assessment year, what we do in assessment year? We assess the income earned by the SSC during the previous year. Then what you do in previous year? You earn your income in the previous year. Okay, but remember always that every single year is a previous year and also an assessment year. These two are related terms, related to each other. Okay, this is the basic rule. No problem, you know, in understanding the basic rule if we know the meaning, if we understand these two basic terms, right? Remember, the basic rule says income earned during the previous year is to be assessed in the immediately succeeding year called assessment year. You must remember this. Okay. Now, though it is the most fundamental rule of income tax, the basic rule. Okay. And the basic rule is to be applied everywhere. Okay. But the nature of income tax is such that even this most fundamental rule of income tax, even this basic rule, has got certain exceptions. Okay. What is the meaning when I say that it got certain exceptions? The rule is that income of this year would get taxed in the next year. Then what would be the exception? The exception is that income of this year would get taxed in the same year. Okay. So many a times they ask, what are the exceptions to the basic rule of income tax? Okay. And many a times they ask, what are the situations where income earned during the previous year got assessed in the same previous year? One and the same thing. Okay. Now let me tell you the exceptions of this basic rule. The exceptions are given in sections, starting from section 172 to 176. Okay. Exceptions. The first exception is under section 172 and it is shipping business of a non-resident. Let me tell you first that these exceptions are nothing but certain situations where we do not apply our basic rule. We simply assess the income earned during the previous year in the same previous year. Why we do so? We do so because we feel that there is a chance of revenue loss in those cases. Okay? And to safeguard ourselves, we do not apply the basic rule in those situations. Because basic rule asks you to wait for the next year. Okay? If somebody has earned certain income in this year, you are waiting for the next year to come, and then only in the next year you are going to assess or you are going to collect the tax of that income which is earned by the SSC last year. Okay? So there are certain situations where we do not find this healthy because there is a fear of revenue loss. So we do not apply the basic rule in those situations and we call them the exceptions of the basic rule. Okay? Now this is one such situation where there is a real risk of revenue loss and therefore we do not apply the basic rule here in this situation. Okay, so this becomes the exception. It means that under this situation, whatever income is being earned by this SSC, we are going to tax that income right in the same previous year. Okay, now let me tell you what this situation is. Please see section 172, and this part is very, very important. Section 172, it says shipping business of a non-resident. Okay. Now, non-resident, it is a term in income tax. If you remember the very first session when I was telling you about your syllabus, okay, I told you that in income tax, your second chapter is on the concept of residential status. Okay. There in the chapter residential status, you would, study certain terms like who is a resident, who is a resident and old resident, who is a non-resident. So what exactly is the meaning of non-resident, you would come to know when we would start the chapter on residential status. But now, just to understand this situation here, okay, I am giving you a very simple meaning of non-resident here. What exactly is non-resident? We would, come to know when we would be doing this chapter on RS, residential status, right? But just for the sake of, understanding this situation here, I am giving you a very simple meaning of this term non-resident. A non-resident is someone who does not belong to India, who has nothing to do with India, who is a person outside India. He belongs to some other nation, some other country outside India. Okay. For example, as we are into, some kind of activities here in India, right now, you are watching this session. Okay. And there would be number of, persons somewhere in USA doing their own activities, right? They have no relation, no link, nothing with India. Okay. If they do not have any kind of link with India, just think that those people are non-residents for us. Okay. So for now, just to understand this situation, the meaning of non-resident is a person who has nothing to do with India, who is outside India. Okay. So now please see, there is a person who is a non-resident. Let us suppose that he is an American citizen, a USA based person. Okay. So he is a non-resident. And this non-resident, he has a business, exactly a shipping business. Okay. He got certain ships which, you know, operates in between various ports. Okay. So that means he is into the shipping business and he is a non-resident. Right. Now please see. The ship of this non-resident, it comes to an Indian port. From the Indian port, he earns certain amount of money. Why? Because, you know, he gets certain passengers from the Indian port. Okay. He shipped certain amount of goods from the Indian port and thereby he would collect the charges for that. You can call it cartage or you can call it fare or anything. Right? So that means he is picking up certain passengers and he is picking, the ship is picking certain goods also. And thereby he is earning some amount of money from an Indian port. Okay? Now, if this ship, it arrives at an Indian port and earns certain amount of income from the Indian port, he got some money received from the Indian port, okay, then in that case, we would not apply our basic rule. The basic rule is that we are waiting up till the next year to assess this ship owner on the income which he earned from the Indian port. No, we are not going to do that, right? In the same previous year, right there, we are going to assess his income. How? The answer is this. Let us suppose that the ship arrived at an Indian port and the ship collected, say, 20 lakhs from this Indian port. Okay? Try to understand the difference between the receipt of money and income. Whatever you receive may not be your income. If you are a shopkeeper and you sell this pen at rupees 100, whether the entire rupees 100 is your income? Now you don't know, sir, no. The shopkeeper's income would be only the profit margin out of this 100 rupees. The 100 rupees is the amount of sale. It is the sale value of this article. Okay, the shopkeeper might have purchased this pen at rupees say 75 and he is now selling it at rupees 100. Okay, so his income, his profit is only 25 rupees. Okay, but in all he received rupees 100. So here the ship has received rupees 20 lakhs. The receipt is 20 lakhs, not the income. Okay, whenever this kind of situations come that a ship which belongs to a non-resident, it arrived at an Indian port. Okay, what we do? We check how much he has received from the Indian port. Okay, now whatever receipts are there from the Indian port, there is a particular percentage we need to apply on those receipts. By applying that percentage, we work out the income of that ship or the ship owner. Okay. Once you work out the income, then we apply the tax rates on that income and work out the tax on this earned income. That amount of tax is to be paid by this ship person, this ship owner, or maybe there is the master of the ship. This would have to be paid, the tax would have to be paid by the master of the ship to the income tax authorities right then and there. Once the tax is paid, then only this ship would be allowed to move further from the port. Got it? This is section 172. Here, we are not applying the basic rule. What we are doing? The income earned by this non-resident in a previous year, we are assessing the income in the same previous year without waiting for the assessment year to come. Got it? This is the first situation. Now, situation number second, and this is section 174. Okay. Now, under section 174, it is a situation under section 174, there is a situation where a person just a second. Section 174, the situation here is that a person is leaving India with no probable intention to come back. A person who is leaving India with no probable intention to come back. This is the situation. Okay. I am just writing only up to this. A person leaving India. Now, the situation is, the full situation is that a person is leaving India with no probable intention to come back. Let us suppose that I plan to move outside India. Let us suppose I want to migrate to USA now. Okay. And I am planning to move out on say 1st of November. Right. Now please see. In this year, from 1st of April to 1st of November, if I am moving out on 1st of November, that means up to 31st October, I might have earned certain amount of income from India. Okay. So I am moving out on 1st November. But the fact is that from 1st April up till 31st October, 7 months, I was in India and I was earning my income here from India. Okay. And now I plan to move out on 1st November. Right. The authorities are asking me that whether I plan to come back. I do not know because I don't really have, you know, a plan for that. I am simply moving outside India. I myself do not know whether I would come back after an year's time or maybe 3 years' time, or I may not come back at all. Okay. So I do not know my own intentions. Only thing is that yes, I am moving out. Okay. Now if this is the situation where a person, either he is not telling the authorities whether he would come back or not. What is his intention? Whether he is going there to settle there permanently or what? He is not telling you anything. Okay. Now, if you come to know that he is going there and he would settle permanently there, right? Or he may or may not come back in near future. If you establish that, then the income tax authorities would assess his income which he has earned from 1st April till this date, 31st October, okay, right in the same previous year, okay. So the situation is very clear. This is the previous year going on, okay. And in this previous year, from 1st April up till 31st of October, in these 7 months, whatever income I have earned, that would get assessed in the same previous year. The income tax authorities would not wait for the assessment year to assess me, right? Why? Because of the situation that I am leaving India, right? And I might not come back in near future. So the income tax authorities, our law, our income tax act says that in this case, there would be a chance of revenue loss. And hence, we should not apply the basic rule here. In such a situation, what we do? We assess the income earned during the previous year in the same previous year, without waiting for the assessment year. Okay. So this is the second situation under section 174. The third exception is under section 174A. Okay. 174A, and this situation is अबाउट द असेसमेंट ऑफ एन एओपी और बीओआई. दीज एओपी और बीओआई विच आर एस्टेब्लिश्ड फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर पर्पस और फॉर अ पर्टिकुलर इवेंट और फॉर अ शॉर्ट टाइम, इन दोज केसेस the income which they have earned during a particular previous year would get assessed in the same previous year. Okay, so any AOPs or BOIs which are made for a particular purpose or for a particular event for a shorter period, then in that case we do not apply the basic rule. Whatever income they have earned, we are going to assess that income in the same previous year. So let me write it. This is section 174A. AOP or BOI created for a particular event or purpose. Let me give you an example for this. Here in North India, somewhere in October, November, at the time of Diwali, many of people, they organize Diwali fests. Okay? Diwali Mela. Okay? Normally, these kind of Diwali Melas, they run for 3-4 days, maximum a week's time. Okay? The purpose of organizing these kind of Diwali Melas is that, you know, people at that time, they are on shopping spree. Okay? So, when you organize a Diwali Mela, it is a very good opportunity to earn some money, some very good money. Okay? So, that is the purpose behind this. So now let us suppose that four friends, they come together without forming a partnership firm. Okay? They created an AOP or BOI, whatever you want to say it. Okay? With the single purpose that they are going to organize a Diwali fete. Okay? And this would last for 7 days. Right? Now, if this is the situation, that there is an AOP, okay, which is meant for a particular purpose, you know, organizing Diwali Mela is a particular purpose, right? Now, in such a situation, we are not going to apply the basic rule. We are not going to wait for the assessment year to assess the income earned during Diwali Mela. Okay? In such a case, we would assess the income earned during the previous year in the same previous year without waiting for the assessment year. Okay, why we do so? Because now you can yourself give the answer, because then there would be a risk of revenue loss. Okay, so these are the situations where all of these situations so far, right, these are there because the income tax authorities, they do not want to incur revenue losses. Right? Now, coming to the next exception here, this is under section 175. Section 175, this gives you a situation where a person is transferring his assets with the objective of evading tax. Transfer of asset for the purpose of evading or avoiding, whatever you want to say, evading or avoiding tax. Section 175, transfer of asset for the purpose of avoiding or evading tax. Let me tell you the situation here. Let us suppose that there is a case, income tax case going on against a particular person. Okay. This person knows that he has not given paid income tax from last many years. And now the income tax authorities, they really would collect their income tax in full and along with penalties and fines. Okay. The person does not have ready money with him, but he have certain assets with him. He knows that the income tax authorities now would collect their dues by selling off these assets. Okay. So what he wishes to do now, he wants to transfer the assets. He wants to sell off the assets himself. Right? Why? What is the purpose? The purpose is that when it comes to the collection of tax by the income tax authorities, okay, they would not find any asset with him so that they would be able to collect the tax dues. So that means his purpose of transferring this asset, his purpose of selling out this asset is to avoid tax. Okay. So in a situation where a person is transferring his asset, now please note that transferring an asset is not a crime. It's not a crime. But transferring an asset with a purpose, with a motive to avoid tax is a crime. Okay. So here what we would do? What we would do? In case the income tax authorities establish that the person is selling off his asset to avoid tax, in that case, whatever income this person has earned during this previous year, this income they are going to assess in the same previous year and they would not for the assessment year. Okay? Because the person has lost its trustworthiness. Okay? If this fact got established that he is trying to sell off his asset because there are certain amount of dues which he needs to pay to the income tax authorities. Right? Then, any income which he has earned during the current previous year, that would get assessed in the same previous year. This is what the situation is under section 175. The last exception is given under section 176, and this is disclosure of a business. Write it this way, closing down of a business. Closing down, closure of a business. Okay. See what is this situation? The situation here is, let us suppose that you have your office somewhere in Connaught Place. Okay. And you have your office in Connaught Place from last, say, 10 years. Okay. Now, in these 10 years, whatever income you earned, honestly, you disclosed all of your income. You filed your ITR in time. You paid all your taxes in time. Okay. The income tax officer of that range, he knows this fact about you. Okay. And now, during this previous year, in between this previous year, you want to close down your business. You want to close down your office. Now, let us suppose that you are closing down your business on, say, 31st of October this previous year. Okay. That means from 1st April till 31st October, in these 7 months, you have earned certain amount of income. Okay. But now, you have closed down your business. Okay. Now, if I ask you, what should the income tax officer do in this situation? What he should do? What he should do? Whether he should apply the basic rule, that means he should wait for the assessment year and then he would assess the income which you have earned during this previous year and you have already closed down your business. Would you give this advice to the assessing officer, to the income tax officer, that wait for the assessment year to come, even though you got a very positive track record that you have never ever avoided your tax. But when you have closed down your business, if you are the income tax officer and you know a person from last 10 years that he is very honestly paying his taxes. But then in this previous year, he has closed down his business. As an income tax officer, would you wait for the assessment year and then in the assessment year you would assess him for this 7 months period's income, or you would like to assess him for the income which he earned during these 7 years right there in the same previous year without waiting for the assessment year? What you would do? Now, I know there would be, you know, different maybe answer from most of you people. Some of you may say that, sir, I would wait for the assessment year. Some of you may not advise this way. They would say that, no, we are not going to wait, because an honest person, when he would, you know, become an dishonest person, nobody knows. Okay? So, your advice would be to immediately assess the income of the previous year in the same previous year without waiting for the assessment year. Okay? What our, you know, Act says about it? What is there in Section 176? Section 176, because we are studying it as an exception to the basic rule, okay, that means it is obvious that one conclusion is that do not wait for the assessment year, and whatever income this SSC has earned during this previous year, that should be assessed in the same previous year. Okay. But this Section 176, it is slightly different from the above five exceptions. From the above four exceptions. In all, there are five exceptions. Okay. What is the difference? The difference is, in the first four exceptions, under 172, 174, 174A and 175, the income tax officer, the assessing officer, is bound to assess this income in the same previous year. But in case of Section 176, in case of the situation where the person is closing down his business, a discretionary power is given to the income tax officer. What? A discretionary power is given to the income tax officer. If he so wishes, he can wait for the assessment year, or if he wishes, he can assess this income in the same previous year also. It is completely at the discretion of the assessing officer. Okay? If he gives more weightage to the past track record of the SSC, then he can wait for the assessment year. Okay? If he feels the other way, then he does not require to wait for the assessment year. In the same previous year, he can assess the income earned during this previous year by this SSC. Okay? But please note that if he decided to wait for the assessment year and there is a revenue loss to the government, to the income tax department, because of his decision, he would be taken personally liable for that loss. Okay? So that means, practically, in almost all cases, even though the income tax officer has got the discretionary power, but in most of the cases, generally, they assess this income in the same previous year without waiting for the assessment year. Though they have this discretionary power given under Section 176 that if they wish, they can wait for the assessment year also. They can assess this income in the regular manner by assessing this in the assessment year. Got it? So these are the five exceptions to our basic rule. What is the basic rule? The basic rule says that income earned during a previous year is to be assessed in the immediately succeeding year called assessment year. The exceptions, five exceptions from Section 172 to 176, and under these five exceptional situations, we do not follow our basic rule and we assess the income earned during the previous year in the same previous year. Got it? So this way this session has come to an end. We discussed the two terms, assessment year, section 2.9, and previous year, section 3. Their relative relation between the two. Our basic rule of income tax and the exceptions to the basic rule. Okay. I'm concluding the session now. Thank you.